Hello, thank you so much for joining me today. Today we're talking about how to start an eco-friendly, sustainable lifestyle. You're in the right place if that is of interest to you, but one thing that I will note, one caveat that is really important is the fact that I am going to tell you about the ways I do things, and that being said, they're very imperfect. I don't think anyone's doing everything perfectly out there, and I think that's okay. This is not a place for judgment. This is not a place for negative energies. This is more about just showing you what my lifestyle is like. There's plenty of things that I'm still doing wrong, but it's also about the learning process. You might be further along than I am, and I think that's absolutely beautiful. So if you want to pop in the comments and tell me how differently you would do things or how you would rethink certain things that I do, I'm so open to feedback. But this is just about telling you what I do, because for the past 4 or 5 years, I've been investing a lot of time, energy, and money, important to note, in making my lifestyle more sustainable, more in line with my ethics. So hopefully I can inspire you a little bit with this listicle. For those of you who are new here, my name is Anna Cha. I'm an environmental content creator. I work for NGOs and camera companies and do a lot of filmmaking and a lot of communications around themes that have to do with the safeguard and the protection of the environment. I've done my studies in biology and Chinese, and I'm very interested in teaching others how to harness the skills in the filmmaking industry, but also learning to care for the planet. So that's a bit about me, but we're not going to spend too much on that, because today I want to talk about how to start a more eco-friendly, sustainable lifestyle. And my top number one tip is food. That's right, maybe it is because I'm French, but I have a huge passion for food, and I'm always thinking about the food that I like, the food that I want to eat, the food that I want to cook, some food that I've eaten a while ago that I really liked. Food is always on my mind. And actually, food has a tremendous impact on the planet and is a really good place you can focus to actually have an impact on having a more sustainable lifestyle, having a more eco-friendly lifestyle. And so, of course, there's a few routes to go, but I'll tell you about what I do. Of course, your diet might be different, and that's totally okay. We all have different means. Not everyone have the possibility of becoming vegan, or there's just a lot of things that have to be taken into account when we're thinking about food. But for my case, I try to limit my meat consumption as much as possible. That doesn't mean I eat zero meat. I do sometimes eat meat just when it happens to be the most convenient, or if I'm being a guest, or if there's nothing else on the menu. So I really just try to avoid it as much as possible. Also, what I want to focus on today is telling you about how important it is to shop locally. And so there's this big debate between organic or local. What is the best? And I think it's a bit of a combination of both. Obviously, organic is great because that means you're not putting chemical inputs into the soil. You're actually taking care of Mother Earth that way. But if organic has to come at the cost of enormous carbon emissions when it comes to transporting that food and making it available in your country, then that sort of poses a problem, right? So my rule is try to be as local as possible. And I was a bit outraged yesterday at the store. Right now in France, it's apple seasons. There's apples everywhere, really good one too. And of course you had a lot of French apples at the supermarket, but you also had pink ladies, which were coming from South Africa. And to me, that just doesn't make sense. I just don't think everything should be available all the time. You have all these different variety, I can't say that word, but all these different types of apples that are on the market that are coming from France. Why do we need to add the South African apples that are traveling so far away to get into our plates? So really trying to favor local food, I think, can go a very long way. Then whether or not you decide to be plant-based is for you to decide, but I think limiting our meat consumptions as much as possible also has a tremendous positive impact on the planet. Second thing I want to mention is zero waste swaps. And so I'm sure you've seen lots of videos about it on internet, on Instagram, on YouTube. Everyone has their own little hacks, and I think that's wonderful. One thing to note though is that you see a lot of influencers out there on Instagram that are seemingly perfectly zero waste, but what you might not take into account is that being zero waste actually costs a lot of money. And in that way, it can be quite exclusive to people who don't have the means to pay as much in buying, you know, reusable sponges or whatever it is. So that's again for you to decide what you can do in that space, but you shouldn't feel the pressure of having to do too much. Once again, the climate crisis here is not our individual fault. 70% of the carbon emissions come from 20 companies in the world. So I think our individual impact is very small. It's very important that we take decisions and that we take actions to flip the narrative, but I think feeling all guilty is not going to be helpful. But in the case of zero waste swaps, what I often encourage is to do with what you already have, right? Or to make a plan to be able to buy something that's going to be zero waste swaps that in the end is going to last you longer than if you're buying the non-reusable product over and over and over again. Of course, zero waste swaps are a great way to be more eco-friendly in your lifestyle, but I think one of the most important thing, not necessarily going for eco swaps, but actually just owning less and buying less. So trying to get out of that consumerist mindset and coming to terms with being happy with the possessions that you really need. So looking at objects and deciding whether they really are going to affect your life. In line with that, I've actually made a video that's linked up there in the cards or here, I'm never sure where they go, but that is about things that I don't buy anymore. So things that I don't see useful in my lifestyle anymore in trying to consume less. So you could find some inspiration there. And for zero swaps, here's a couple that are just showing up on screen right now. Easy to do, some are more costly than others. So you also have to figure out what your budget is in that sphere when you're trying to make eco swaps. That being said, there's lots of eco swaps that are actually free. For example, preserving your mason jars when you're buying products. Right now I have a mason jar right here that's being used as cable storage, right? And so I bought it and there was food in it and now it's being used as cable storage. And in my kitchen I have so many jars just that I bought with tomato sauce or different produce in it that I reuse for storage. So this is just one example of the many ways that you can make eco swaps that are already available for you in your home. Next one I'm gonna mention is maybe a bit unusual. And so it's talking about cleaning up your bathroom closet. And I'm especially talking to people who maybe have a lot of care products or makeup products or just products in their bathroom. And the tip is to clean it up. And it's not in the sense that I want you to throw everything and buy new things. No. First of all, you should always finish something that you already have, even if it's not perfect. That's just a general rule of being a more sustainable human, is to finish things through, even if they're not perfect. But what I mean is that there's a lot of toxic chemicals that are being put in our self-care products by pharmaceutical companies, and they can be actually quite harmful to our health. I've done a whole Facebook, not Facebook, who uses Facebook anymore, an Instagram post on chemical products that are making us ill, and you can find it right here or linked below in the description. But I really want to put emphasis on how bad it is for ourselves, but also how bad it is for the planet, because that implies that these pharmaceutical companies are using these toxic chemicals in our products that are then leaching into the soil, leaching into the environment, and leaching into our bodies. So one way that I'm practically able to tell if a product has negative compounds in it versus another is I use an app that's called Yuka, and I'm going to show you how it works right now. Nope, this is not an ad. This is just an app that I use in my daily routine to check whether products are good. It actually works for food as well, but for this purpose, I'm going to show you for beauty products and self-care products. So I have a couple here. And I will start, for example, with my face wash, which is from Yves Rocher. And so what I'll do is, it just works as a scanner, and I will scan the product here, scan the barcode, and it will come up with a little summary of whether it's good or bad. It will give you a rating out of 100 and explain to you what are the ingredients that may be risky. And so you can see this one is really highly rated. It's 93 out of 100. I try to keep most of my products upwards of 70s and above, and anything that is below, I try to Not buy, first of all, or if I do have them in my bathroom, finish them, but not buy them ever again. And so, one example of that, right here, this is a face wash. It's actually my brother's, so don't tell him that I have it. I'm going to scan it here, and you can see it's a 32 out of 100. And there are lots of zeros. You know, 32 is actually not that bad, but 32 is not something that I'd want to get involved with. There's a lot of things that are low risk, but I just don't like that there's a risk. There's something that is moderate risk, and here it says phenoxylphenol, can't pronounce that, is used primarily as a preservative. This preservative is also known to be toxic for the liver and the blood. It is also suspected to have effects on the hormones and fertility. How wonderful. So yeah, this is one of the products that I'd look into getting rid of. And so what I'll do in stores or pharmacies when I'm buying my self-care product is actually scan every single product to make sure that it is safe. Probably makes me look really weird, but in that case, I'm very interested in not putting toxic chemicals in my body. So this is just that little practical tip for you, and hopefully you find that helpful. Shopping secondhand is one of my favorite thing to do in the world. I love secondhand shopping. That's where I tend to get most of my clothes, whether it's in physical store or apps like Vinted and whatnot. Even purchasing furniture secondhand is something I do a lot. So I just moved to this new apartment in Brittany, which I'll show you around in just a second. But I've done a lot of shopping for it, well, most of it, if not all of it, secondhand in those secondhand furniture stores. So that is a great way to just get into the habit of circular economy, getting in the habit of just reusing things instead of letting them go to waste. That being said, caveat, there's a caveat for everything really in life. Is that you want to be mindful of your consumption of secondhand goods, especially if you have the means to buy more expensive products, or if you, what I'm trying to say is that there are people out there who rely on thrift shopping, secondhand shopping for living. That is something that they need. And so if we privileged people like myself, I consider myself privileged, take everything away, then they have no resources left. And so the whole sort of fashionability of secondhand can be a bit toxic in that way. So just be mindful of your consumption, like everything. You don't need all of it. Maybe you can take one shirt, two shirts without buying the whole bulk secondhand store. The next thing I want to mention is actually quite important and something that I think is really important emphasizing in the sort of sustainable, eco-friendly, zero waste type of world is embracing the imperfect. Life is not perfect. I mean, we like to believe it is in books, movies, or even projections that we make of ourselves on Instagram, pretending everything is perfect, but life just doesn't work that way. Nothing is ever perfect, and you'll never be perfect, and I think that's okay. And I think coming to terms with the fact that there's gonna be people out there that are giving you advice but aren't perfect, wink wink, like myself, and it's fine. We all have our own journey, and I think as long as we're interested in those subjects, actually trying to make a difference in our own means, then that is already a lot. So just being kind to yourself and learning that imperfectness, I don't think that's a word, imperfectibility, not sure that's a word either, but whatever that concept is good, and it's a good thing. Without any words before, so why stop now?